Greetings, everyone. On behalf of all of the faculty, research scientists, and graduate students here at SciAll, I want to congratulate the graduating class of 2021. Congratulations, everybody. You did it. You made it. College is over. Now, if you have just recently graduated with a bachelor's degree related to STEM fields, and you're curious or you're interested or thinking about what a career in marine science might be like for you, I'm sure you still have many pressing questions. Questions like, what's life going to be like after college? What are my next steps? How am I going to be competitive? Yeah, well, here are the answers that I got. It had been 2 long years since I graduated from college. Up to this point, I had fully committed myself to becoming a marine biologist. But after 2 short internships, I had yet to get into a graduate program or find a job. However, what I did not realize was that I was well on my way to becoming a marine biologist. Although my previous experience couldn't get me into graduate school or a long-term job, it did get me a part-time paid position at a study abroad facility on the desert-like Caribbean island of Bonaire. This internship in many ways transformed my understanding of the field of marine biology. After 8 months of continuous diving, teaching, and ecological research, I finally felt for the first time validated as a marine biologist. And after that, I never looked back. My name is Colin, and I'm a scientist who gets excited when talking about coral reefs or the ocean. But I'm also inspired when I meet ambitious and passionate early career scientists. And I find motivation in sharing ocean stories that reveal deep connections with their very own lives. Over the years of study and research in the Caribbean, I am determined not only to learn as much as I can, but to share what I've learned the best way I can. Word, that internship was absolutely awesome. I loved every minute of it. Now, for most recent graduates, getting your foot into the door into a job or the field of marine science is very important. But I'm sure for many of you, you will quickly realize how challenging and competitive finding a career or building a career within marine science can be. Now, if you've just come out of college, I'm sure you've been given one option consistently over and over and again, and that is grad school, right? Yay, more school. However, if you're like me who struggled to get into grad school right out of college, or if you're just completely burned out and you need a break from before going back into school, right, before committing to more school, or even if you're somebody who simply just needs to start working right now and make some income, right? Thinking about internships, volunteering, and study abroad teaching opportunities can be a really effective and useful way for you to develop your skill sets and your background and build your career within marine science or marine biology. In other words, it's totally fine if you decide to take some time after college before you hop back into graduate school, or before you find a real long-term and promising job, right? It's okay. In fact, I encourage a lot of recent graduates to take the time to look at opportunities like internships or volunteering opportunities, because not only will you be able to develop skill sets and experience within a particular field, but you'll also be able to fine-tune and kind of dial in your interests to whatever area or field within marine science or marine biology you're interested in. It's true, marine science is such a huge, ginormous field. There's so many different positions that fall within the umbrella term of marine science, right? And if you think about it, that means there are probably equal to, if not more, internships, volunteering, and study abroad teaching opportunities, work studies, and things like this for you to choose from. And so in today's video, I thought it would be best to talk about the best ways to evaluate and critique and select the particular internships that might fit your needs. And at the end, I'm gonna talk a little bit about, in my opinion, the best way to apply and hopefully land a job at these internships. Right, so let's get started. So first off, one of the most important questions, I think, and the first question you should really ask is this internship paid? Now, I'm sure many of you who are thinking about marine science are well aware of the fact that most of these type of entry-level positions won't be paid very much or paid at all. And that is unfortunately a real aspect of this career, and these situations definitely need to change. However, although certain internships may not be able to provide you income in any real way, they can also provide some kind of support, and that usually looks like room and board. They can cover meals, they can cover transportation if the facility is remote. And so when you're evaluating these different internships, trying to, even though some of these may not be paid, look into what they offer and whichever one of these might actually fit your needs. Now, my background, my experience is tropical marine ecology. And for these kinds of really popular and exciting heavy field work, you know, remote traveling involved and all this stuff, you can also run the risk of bumping into internships that you have to pay for. It's called pay-to-play internships, where you pay to work at a particular facility or location. If you are somebody like me who refuses to pay to work, or if you simply cannot afford that kind of opportunity, this is a situation where volunteering can actually be a very effective, and in this case, cost-effective alternative to paid internships, right? Volunteering is awesome, especially if you already have a main 9-to-5 that may not necessarily be within STEM or marine science, but you're still determined and you're still motivated to pursue that as a career. And so as you're working, having a volunteer experience at a local aquarium, at a state park, anywhere outdoors that's environmental in nature, can give you the behind the scenes access and hands-on training and experience without the full commitment of an internship or even kind of like a part-time job. And so it provides the most amount of flexibility, especially for those who are holding a different job. And so when thinking about different types of opportunities, it's helpful to consider it in this fashion. Volunteering is going to be much more cost effective and more efficient than paying for an internship. The only circumstance where a paid internship would be ideal is if you're just receiving some kind of tangible deliverable. That usually looks like some sort of widely recognized certification, or if you're still in college, I've seen certain cases where you can pay for college credits, and those are actually really useful. And so there are a lot of different options, and it's important to think about the financial aspect of any internship you take on. Number two is thinking about the length of this internship, right? Generally, you want to focus or put some emphasis towards internships that are at least 4 months to a year. That's around the average sweet spot for most internships, right? Anything less than that is maybe less ideal. Why? Participating in an internship that actually lasts several months gives you a realistic shot at developing some kind of deliverable as well. This item can be really useful in selling your ability to be productive, to show your determination and hard work, and you're more likely to be able to produce something like that with longer internships compared to something that's less than 4 months. Now I get it, if you're still in college and you're trying to get ahead of the game and get into some internships, then yeah, you only have a few months during the summer and even less time during the winter months. And so then less than 3 months is ideal. However, if you're after college, I would highly encourage you to think about internships that are 4 months or longer. Now another great metric that you can use when comparing internships is their intern history. If you take the time to go to the website, and a lot of the good internships will have this, they'll have a section in their website that lists all of their previous interns over the years. And this can be a real treasure trove of information that can be useful and help you identify and select certain attributes that are highly favored at this particular internship, right? Each of these interns in the past will be asked to write some kind of blurb or background information about them. And if you're able to briefly read through a couple of these and see certain trends in skill sets or experiences or interests that are generally hired at this, that can be useful in highlighting similar interests that you may have, right? It can also provide information for how many interns they hire and how often. Is this internship offered every spring, summer, and fall, or is it just in the spring and the fall? How many interns each season do they hire? How many spots are available, right? A lot of useful information can help you identify which internships you have a better shot of applying to and getting an interview and hopefully getting hired. So overall, just as there are many different types of internships and volunteering opportunities, there are a lot of useful methods and metrics that you can use to evaluate, compare, and to select the internships that are going to work great for you. Now I want to switch gears and talk about, in my opinion, what are the best ways to apply for these types of internship opportunities, right? And there are two major rules or suggestions that I have that can really set your application above the rest and actually have each evaluator spend as much time looking at your resume compared to others. From my experience, I've had some small opportunities to sit on the other side of the table and to learn how to evaluate applications from interns, and this is where I'm getting my information from. One of the most important things to think about and one of the most important rules to follow when writing your application is following the rules. It makes a difference when you actually format and organize your application specifically how it is specified in the job description. It is an easy early indication for the evaluators to determine who is actually able to follow rules and instructions. Because like when you're reviewing 100 different applications, the page numbers matter. The number of pages that they allot on your CV matters. What is contained within your CV or resume matters. How long your cover letter is, the word count, these things are used to expedite the application process and to make your application as concise as possible. And so one of the most important things I can encourage you to do is actually take the time and read exactly how your application should be submitted. And the second most useful tip that I have for anyone who might be applying for internships is to tailor your internship to the specific agency or facility you're applying to. I have met a lot of really ambitious and motivated undergraduates and recent graduates where they have a bunch of different applications and they've put a lot of effort and time into one version of their cover letter and resume and they shotgun blast that through all the different ones. And in reality, and in many ways, that could be effective. If you apply to 50 or 100 internships, more than likely one or two of them actually may trickle out of that and you might get an interview. However, if you take your time and evaluate each of these different internships, it'll prep you up so you know exactly what to expect if you do get an interview or if you do actually get hired. And it actually is a really effective way to sell yourself to this particular agency or organization. As an evaluator, if you're reading a resume and a cover letter, and there's the theme and the topic is very related or similar to the expectations and the details outlined in the job description, these are going to be the ones where the evaluator is going to spend more time reading and trying to understand compared to other applications. And this can be somewhat clear at times that application actually is not intended for this particular university or this particular internship or this particular opportunity. There are a lot of different, you can see a lot of small grammatical errors or just oddly placed phrases or words. There are certain signs that evaluators have learned to recognize where it's clear that this particular application wasn't designed for or wasn't specified to the job description. It was more of a generic version. And so if you're able to accomplish these two things, if you're able to follow both of those, it already will set you in the good pile at the very least and will give you the opportunity for these evaluators to really look over your resume, to question certain things, to go back and forth between your resume and cover letter. And that is what you want. The longer their eyeballs are spent on your application, the better, because that ultimately gives you the best chance at potentially getting an interview and ultimately getting a job or getting that position, getting that internship. And once you're in, you can continue to develop and build your skill sets and continue to build your career path towards marine science or marine biology. Now, if you like content like this and you would like to learn more about how to find and build a successful and rewarding career within not only marine science or marine biology, but STEM in general, please hit the like button and feel free to subscribe. Here on this channel, SciAll is a compilation of a bunch of different ambitious and motivated and seasoned veterans within all aspects of science and STEM. And we are pumping out videos consistently every week on multiple different topics. And if you're really interested in wanting to learn more, please stay tuned for more. I'm really excited to continue making videos like this, and I will see you soon.